In an isolated countryside home in Sweden, Alexander wonders about his relationship with God, his family, and the progression of modern humanity. His friend, Otto, has developed a more esoteric worldview in order to help him sort out his life. His wife, Adelaide, lives a life of regret. His son, called Little Man, says nothing at all. Alexander, his friends, and his family learn of a coming nuclear war. In a panic, Alexander bargains with God, saying that he will sacrifice what he loves most in order to protect the world. Alexander sets fire to his own home. He races around like a madman chased by his loved ones, all while watching it burn to cinders. The world does not end. An explanation for what happened is never given. With this in mind, did Alexander save the world, or was the world never in danger? Was the sacrifice of his home in vain? And was it a sincere act of faith, or only an act of desperation? Early in the film, Alexander is greeted by Otto. After some pleasantries, Otto begins to pontificate on the works of 19th century German philosopher Friedrich Nietzsche. Specifically, he references, perhaps incorrectly, the eternal recurrence, sometimes called eternal return, a concept in Nietzsche's work that the philosopher considered his most important idea. Otto says that the world begins, ends, and then starts again. People begin, end, and start again. Everything that happens has happened before, and everything will happen in exactly the same way again. To Otto, this is the eternal recurrence, but most interpreters of Nietzsche's work do not see it quite that way. Nietzsche's explanation of the doctrine, indeed nearly all his doctrines, involves a lot of hypothesizing and writing that superficially looks like the ranting of a madman. Everything becomes and recurs eternally. Escape is impossible. Supposing we could judge value, what follows? Nietzsche's presentations are generally presented in hypotheticals, elusive bombast, or metaphorical rigmarole. A cursory glance at his concept of eternal recurrence would give someone the idea that it is cosmological or spiritual. In fact, that was an early interpretation, as it appears to be in line with Otto's interpretation as well. The group quietly awaiting the end of days is connected with this interpretation. Humanity has begun, as it had been a previous time, it will end in nuclear annihilation, and it will reoccur. When Nietzsche declared that God was dead, believers in this, really meaning that God never existed, faced a new reality without the possibility of an everlasting reward, without eternity itself. Under eternal recurrence, instead, we have a life that repeats forever instead of a life that goes on forever. However, modern interpretation of eternal recurrence suggests that it is more of a thought experiment about how one lived one's life. Imagine an endless return of life, and one's reaction to the prospect reveals something about how valuable one's life has been. In this interpretation, it is more about regret than about fate or a cyclical existence. If one were comfortable imagining life repeating itself exactly the same way, then in this thought experiment, you would say that you had a good life. If not, then it was not. We see this in the film too. Alexander's wife, Adelaide, says that he threw everything away long ago. He was once a theater actor. She loved being the wife of a great actor. Later, regret about marriage is brought up. Speculation about what life would have been like, perhaps better, married to someone else. What do we regret at the end of our lives? What would we be willing to give up to change it? When the news program announces the possible end of the world, we should see this not as an earth-ending event so much as it is a metaphor for death itself, feeling like the end of the world. For someone, it is the end of their world. They will no longer exist to experience it. For the faithful, this is not so, but can Alexander be counted among their numbers? In the beginning of the film, Otto asks Alexander about his relationship with God. Alexander responds that it is non-existent. Does Alexander share any Nietzschean qualities? Nietzsche charged Christianity with the nihilism he once spoke of because, to him, it depreciates the only life we definitely have, life on Earth, for the sake of an unknown and possibly absent afterlife. The coming apocalypse in the film connects with Nietzsche's writings as well, placing an emphasis on humankind, its being in the world, and its coming in existence. Yet, Alexander rejects the notion that God is dead and instead makes an appeal to God to save his world. Alexander says that he will sacrifice whatever he has in order to convince God to spare the earth. This whole sacrifice business is a little confusing, though. From one perspective, it looks as if Alexander is prepared to give up anything to save the world, but from another perspective, if the world is about to end anyway, is anything he could sacrifice meaningful? For example, if he wanted to sacrifice a goat to save the world, the goat is going to die one way or another, either by his hand or by the hand of God. Alexander offers to sacrifice all he loves, but since he loves his son more than anything, that is the offering to God. This is, of course, reminiscent of the biblical story of Abraham and Isaac. 19th century Danish philosopher Søren Kierkegaard wrote extensively of this story and its differing perspectives in his work entitled Fear and Trembling. To Kierkegaard, there are a variety of ways to view the binding of Isaac. In one, Abraham was willing to sacrifice Isaac because he believed God was always right. In another, Abraham was willing to sacrifice Isaac because he feared the wrath of God if he did not. In another still, Abraham only prepared to sacrifice Isaac because he knew God was good and therefore would spare his son. Of this, Kierkegaard said, "The ethical expression for what Abraham did is that he meant to murder Isaac. The religious expression is that he meant to sacrifice Isaac, but precisely in this contradiction is the anxiety that can make a person sleepless, and yet without this anxiety, Abraham is not who he is." Applying this to the sacrifice, is Alexander's offering legitimate? Is he willing to give up everything he has to selflessly save the world, or does he know that if nothing is left after the apocalypse, there is no harm in giving up everything anyway? Is this a test from God? Is this actually what God wants? In the end, Alexander makes his offering by burning down his home. Earlier in the film, he spoke of how important it was to him. Perhaps Alexander's sacrifice was less about his desire to save the world and more about his desire to re-establish his relationship with God, to cast aside thoughts of a never-ending cycle of life and focus once again on the possibility of an everlasting reward, to eschew Otto's Nietzschean ideals and embrace his God instead. His act of burning down his home with the sure knowledge it will convince God to spare the earth would make him, to Kierkegaard, a knight of faith, someone who has made a leap of faith into the absurd by which the knight regains everything he has lost, or in this case, sacrificed. Then again, what we are witnessing in the film is a kind of deathbed conversion, the adoption of religious faith when approaching death. Perhaps the earliest of such conversions as it relates to Christianity is the crucified thief in the Gospel of Luke. He expresses his belief in Jesus Christ, and upon hearing this, Jesus claims that they will see each other in heaven. Much like the faithfulness of Abraham, this could be seen a number of ways. Did the thief convert because of a genuine conviction or because he was afraid of death and wanted to safeguard himself in case heaven existed? Is Alexander suddenly sure of the existence of God and is now willing to make a sacrifice to him, or, now, faced with certain doom, does he simply feel that this attempt at sacrificing his home is worth a shot, considering it will either yield a positive result or no result? The home will be burned anyway in a nuclear disaster. When giving Alexander a painting, Otto says, "Every gift involves a sacrifice. If not, what kind of gift would it be? But if this gift to God will be destroyed either way, is it a real sacrifice?" Maybe Alexander is more desperate than faithful. The world is not destroyed in the film. The ending shows Alexander's son still alive and lying by a tree. Did Alexander save the world, or was the world never in danger? Mistaking the application of causation in worldly events to God has always been common. Parsing what is sincere faith and what is selfish lip service to God is challenging. It may even be impossible to determine. not just in regards to someone else, but in regards to one's own convictions. Hi everyone. If you like what I do, please click on the orange Patreon link below. That's how this show happens. It's also how you can request an episode. There are also a lot of other perks for being a patron, so check it out. The information is on my Patreon page. Please remember to like, share, and subscribe. I'll see you next week.